Good afternoon. My name's Andy, the furniture maker. I'm very pleased to meet you. There's somebody here interviewing me, but they're going to edit him out. So I've got to tell you all these things on myself. Should we start again? Well, I come from this place, right, where you either got married and had a mortgage or died on a motorbike before you were 18. It's called Brightlingsea in East Anglia. It's a little sink port, you know. It's a friendly place. It's so small, everybody knows everybody. And people are just like, they've lived there for so long, it doesn't make any difference anymore. I first started making furniture on February the 9th, 1983, which I think was, I don't know, some day of the week or other. Anyway, I got up and I was really bored and I had no furniture and I thought I was really pissed off with having nowhere to sit and nowhere to eat and not even anywhere to sleep, really. So I decided to make some furniture, so I went out into the street, found an old pallet board, took it home, went round and borrowed some tools off of a friend and made a chair. Got up the next day, did more or less the same thing, but maybe went out of 2x2 in this old box that I had that I used to sit on upside down. And about a week later, I took some Polaroids round to a friend and sold one piece just like that. 150 quid for a chair. It's not bad, was it, eh?
How long has he been making furniture for? Not much more than 3 years. You know, it had lots of style and was very good and very strong and rather extraordinary. Hmm? I mean, I'd never thought of, you know, it was a rather amazing idea to make furniture out of, you know, found wood, as it were, on the street. It was very sort of city furniture and all that. Yeah, he's very, I mean, he's an extraordinary character. I mean, he's a very self-destructive individual in many ways. I mean, he's moody and he's very morose sometimes. He can be very aggressive. But above all, I mean, he's an intensely creative individual. And I think what his furniture really shows is extraordinary imagination, above all, and a sort of feeling of making the right piece for the right person. And every piece is very carefully thought out and made. And it's a sort of feat of imagination. It's kind of sculpture, really.
They're just old boats that were, like, left there hundreds of years ago, and they've just, like... You can see, even when they built the new customs office, they didn't bother to move them. They just leave them there. They look nice. Do you know what I mean? Look at all those old things over there, those stands there where they used to put the fishing boats up against. You know, they don't use them anymore. They could take them away, but they don't bother. They just leave it. Yeah, oh, the boating lanes, yeah, that was fab. When we were kids, we used to go and hire a boat. It was like 6 minutes for half an hour. We'd have 25 minutes worth of fun, then we'd sink the boat. We used to steal the sailing boats. We used to get like four of us. We'd have like this sailing boat, and then we'd be on it, and we'd wait for the sort of like the guy that ran the place, the attendant, to go in the hut, and we'd pick up the boat out of the water and put it onto the sea, and go sailing for a couple of hours. And he couldn't find the boat, so he couldn't get it in. You see, this man used to stand in one of those sort of like loud hailer things, like, oh, come in number 19 or whatever. Worked on the oyster fishery. And we used to have to go right up there. You can't see it, but there's an island right up there. In Peewee. And we used to go up there in a little boat, like one of those ones down there, in the fog and everything, storms, the lot. Oh, I used to get up at 5, 6 o'clock in the morning, make a flask of soup and some sandwiches. We had to work.
Do I have to say something now?
Yeah, you got to talk.
Oh,
now.
Christ,
yeah.
Go on in. Go on in. Oh, that's awkward. Doing this awkward like that.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really a bit off-putting. Yeah, yeah. Bloody right.
Tell me about the time, tell Andy about the time you sort of.
Oh, well, when he was being a bit lippy as normal, being a bit cheeky. So I decided the best thing was to chuck him over the side of the boat and put his head right next to the prop, which is.
The propeller. Yeah, it's the propeller. It makes the boat go along the prop.
Just to get his sort of wash his senses into him. And I did it as well. When he was saying underwater, like, you bastard, you bastard. You couldn't hear, all you could hear is. Pretty good, really. but yeah, there's several times that he's been like that. Still the same. Yeah. He's going to be the same, isn't he? So you reckon? I should think so.
Just got a bit bigger, that's all.
Yeah, only a little bit.
Only a little bit.
Still a bit of a wimp anyway, yeah.
That's nice. That's nice.
Wait, can't even shave in the mornings.
When you had a tall shipment come in, the relay. Yeah.
Coltech.
You used to have to bring them.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It was like this all day long.
That's why I got my limp wrist.
Put them in a dinghy.
That
little dinghy just come up in.
Oh.
Then you take them board out, put them board to smack. And then we used to bring them up here. Then we used to take them, tip them over onto the deck and shuffle them over the side. Then they'd take them ashore, carry them up.
Yeah, we used to carry them up the buckets and bags.
No, four wheels, and drag them up to the shed and tip them out on the bench. Knock all the weed and barnacle on the ring off.
Then they were put back in the fucking water again.
There's no need for that bastard language.
There used to be a shed there, actually. Yeah, there's an old tractor in there and everything. That's a lifting mechanism, really. It's for lifting, like, the trays of oysters and things out. But we used to be there, you know, and it's like a piffer stove in the middle, you know? We used to bring bags of coal and everything in the boat, you know, half underweight of coal and all with us. It was fabulous. That's a good time there. I want to go ashore. Oh, look, the tractor's still there, look. Can you see it? Yeah, that is the hut that we worked in. But that looks all right. I reckon we could get up there. He could beach this thing. Yeah, man, he goes at full blast. We just wait for the tide to lift us off. Don't take about 2 hours. You see, on the top, on the level bit, there's only a little tiny bit that's level, and there's all these oyster beds there, and they're the ones I used to fall in when I was trying to pull the fucking bags out. And they used to just leave me, you know? It used to be like February, and I'd be soaked through the skin at 8 o'clock in the morning, and they're just like, get on with your work and get away from that fire. I used to have to do it, you know? For 12.5p an hour I used to get. Can you believe it? 12.5 fucking pence an hour. Right away, my life meant for scraping oysters.
20 years of madness, soon I tasted, took it all in one big mighty swipe. 20 years have gone and they've all been wasted. Someone hand me down that opium pipe. Oh, dream tobacco, take me away where there ain't no memories to lead me astray, where I can hear sweet music all the livelong day. Dream tobacco, take me away. Sitting on the beach with the sky above me, maybe there's a sea breeze riding free. I don't want the beach nor the sky above me, I don't want the sea breeze blowing on me. Many miles away is a gentle country, way inside of that lies a sleepy farm. Once I used to live in that gentle country, now I can't believe I was born on that farm. Oh, dream tobacco, take me away where there ain't no memories to lead me astray, where I can hear sweet music all the livelong day. Dream tobacco, take me away. Here is my advice, just in case you're listening. Never let your fool heart rule your head. When the sun goes in and the rays are glistening, just put out the lights and jump into bed. Always think it out in the light of reason, even though your best girl has done you wrong. If I'd thought it out in the light of reason, I guess I wouldn't be here singing this song. Oh, dream tobacco, take me away where there ain't no memories to lead me astray, where I can hear sweet music all the livelong day. Dream tobacco, take me away.
I joined the Navy when I was 15, the Merchant Navy. Childhood fantasy, don't bother to do it, it's terrible, you know. Get called names for the first 2 years that you're at sea. Yeah, I stuck it for 3.5 years, and I had to leave. Well, I didn't really have to leave. I came to London for the day and I've been here ever since.
What were your first first thoughts in London, first arrival?
Well, I met this boy that was the same age as me, and I always thought homosexuals were like 40 with overweight and balding. So I had to stay when I met somebody my own age. I went to Piccadilly and got picked up by this boy, and then I was taken to the Earl's Court, and I went to the Colhern. We used to go to the Regency and the Apollo, and what was the other name of the other one? He tried pretending a dance is just a dance, but I see he's dancing his way back to me. When I went to the Regency and got smashed out of my head every night, you know. Well, it was all sort of like really rough rent boys and sort of horrendous old queens that were like punters, you know, men that pay for boys. And just like drug abusers, transsexuals, transvestites, just every kind of degenerate you could imagine went there. It was fabulous. You could sort of like do anything you wanted. At the same time, there was like, are you looking at my boyfriend? We'll hold this then. You know? It was violent, but it was fun, you know? It was friendly in a funny way. Very nerving place, though. Well, I had all this money at first, but then after that, when it ran out, you know, I didn't know what to do, so became a rent boy for a while, met a few characters. Well, Shepherd's Market really was mainly women, and they'd be driving along, and if there wasn't any women about, I used to jump in the car and just say, well, I do. 99% of the time you did. So all they wanted was a wank, so. And the women got more, so you could ask for more. No, I don't see there's any point coming to London to be a rent boy, you know, because it doesn't do you any good. You just end up taking drugs you don't want to take. You meet people that you don't really need to meet ever in your life because they're that disgusting, you know. I think it's terrible that kids come down here and think, oh, you know, I'll go on the rent scene for 6 months, make a couple hundred, well, thousands of pounds. They all think they're going to make an absolute fortune, and they come down here and they're making maybe 30 quid a day and spending 20 quid to live somewhere, you know. And they spend the other 10 going out looking for a punter, you know, buying the drinks, waiting for somebody to pick them up, you know. It's like...
Was it boring?
Boring is fucking tedious work, you know? Can you imagine getting an erection to order, you know? I don't get an erection when somebody wraps a £20 note round it, you know? It takes a bit more than that.
Heaven sent this boy for rent. sent this boy's friends.
I met Andy. I was down in a discotheque called Bangs one evening, and there was this lad rather drunk against the bar. And I went up and said hello to him, and he said, fuck off. And so I thought, well, people have said that to me once too often. And so I wrote my phone number down on a piece of paper and said, said Derek, you know, 24. Bleep that one. Otherwise, it'll be going. And I gave him this piece of paper. And I didn't hear anything else. And the next thing I heard was a social worker ringing me up and saying, there's this lad in Ashford, remand home. He needs to be bailed out. I think it was 250 quid. And I went down there, and I mean, I received Andy at full volume. I mean, screaming, I'm going to fucking kill you, to the prison guards. So I thought, well, this is, I mean, what have I got on my hands? So I told him to shut up. I said, look, you know, I mean, let's get out of this place. I've come down to collect you. And, you know, just calm down. So I acquired Andy. This is about 7 years ago. And that was how we started, how we began.
Push T.
Push T.
Here, you push T that way. You just push that way. And then T.
God, I don't know. I'm going to stop the whole thing.
Yes, I've got footage of him doing the first bed, which is the first videotape I ever took. Christopher's roof. Yeah, I mean, Andy came and stayed in the warehouse down on the riverbank for a few weeks. And before he moved out, and I mean, he started to actually, you know, get his own life together. But he was in and around from that point onwards. And he started to work with Christopher.
When we were doing Jubilee, in Jubilee year, of course, with Derek Jarman. And Andy sort of turned up. He was having a little of his usual trouble in the early years, as it were. And Derek said, look, have you got anything you can do usefully? So I was doing some enormous plaster pots at the time. So I said to Andy, you know, would you like to help me doing the cast of these things? And he came along, and he was very useful and helpful, but not the best plasterer in the world. But he enjoyed it. It took his mind off other things, I think. And he was obviously a sort of fairly alarming creature in those days, and he still is sometimes. He had a sort of electricity about him. There was, you know, you felt there was more to him than was just immediately visible. And you couldn't just ignore him. I felt somehow he was worth helping out even a little bit, you know, if one could. And he responded terrifically. I mean, that was the nice thing, I think. You know, if you just sort of, if you had an opportunity, he grabbed it like mad. I mean, the first things he made were fairly simple. I mean, they were based on the sort of carpenter's furniture you find in junkyards, almost, in junk markets. But it became very obvious that he knew exactly what he was doing just by nature, really. He had a perfect eye for proportion. It was quite extraordinary. It was rather sort of creepy, really, in a sense. Because, I mean, he put two pieces of wood, and they were always the right two pieces of wood somehow. He just made things balance beautifully. And I've got a rather grand bed, which he whizzed up for me. I actually asked for something rather simple to get me off the floor, and when he delivered it, this is a great state bed, actually. I'm not grumbling.
I apologise. Oh, God. I can't do this. Andy's making me laugh. If you could just keep your eyes to yourself, then I could do it. Oh, don't, Andy, please don't. Put your hand down from your face and try and look normal. Andy, which was your favourite nightclub?
Oh, the Regency. It was the first disco, really. Had a dance floor as big as a kitchen table. Uh-huh. They used to have drag shows in it. It was like a corridor as well, so funny. Tackiest drag ever. People used to spike people's drinks all the time, you know. So I think somebody spiked my drink one night, because I went down to the Hilton and because the steering wheel's on the opposite side, you know, and there's American cars. As this guy got out, the chauffeur had gone to the wrong side, the doorman had gone to the wrong side of the car. So as this guy got out, I jumped in and drove off in the car. This huge American Chevrolet Impala. Chevy Impala. and it was snowing, and I found this sheepskin jacket in the back, so I put that on, and I thought, well, I'll open the roof while I was driving around, but you're meant to stop when you open the roof, otherwise they lock into position. And it locked straight up in the air. So I started to drive around the West End in this thing, you know. Didn't drive at all, you know, it was so wide. Column shift, didn't know what it was, you know. I was going, like, 1 minute I was going, like, reasonable, you know, and the next minute I was like, one, you know, where's it go?
Chevy Impala. My Chevy Impala. Cruising down in Soho like a blind man at the flicks. Getting friendly with my baby's gear stick. I see you smiling, Bobby. I'm the boy he's picked. Gotta move as fast as my Chevy takes me.
And I was like bumping traffic all the time. And then this police car started to follow me, you know. And then I went down this sort of like back street and I hit this mini. And I was so bummed. I put it in the reverse and I reversed out. Then I put it into forward again and I just drove straight into the mini again. And I did this about six times and wrecked the mini completely.
Chased by the squad car, burned the night away. My little Chevy star off the motorway. Oh, my Chevy wants you to stay. A flash is a razor gun, fast the speed of light. Scream as the cat's eyes fly in the light. Oh, my Chevy's taking me away.
And then all of a sudden there was these security guards were chasing me down the street. So I jumped out of the car and I started to run all through Mayfair. And I was running for about half an hour and I run down this cul-de-sac. And I'm like, oh, for fuck's sake. So I hid underneath this car that was parked. Right. And there was like 15, 20 minutes past, I could still see all these big black boots, you know, big shiny steel toe cap, Dr. Martens and everything, you know. And there was one standing right next to the car. And all of a sudden, I heard click. Somebody got in the car to drive off, so I had to get out. I had to get out from underneath the car, and it was like all these policemen, and I was like grabbed.
And what happened?
Fine £25.
For stealing the car.
Well, no, I got £20 for stealing the car and £5 for stealing a packet of cigarettes from the car.
Well, I think we've all got darker sides, Paul. I think Andy's one of those people where it shows more and he goes through real ups and downs and crisis periods, but it's something, I've been writing about on the Caravaggio script, someone who, you know, would have quiet periods, worked intensely, and then go out on a binge and lose themselves for a month or two. And on the whole, these have become less extreme, although it's still there. I'm well aware of it.
Yes, I mean, he's very uncompromising, certainly in the way he works. And it may be his tough image comes through, certainly in the beginning, when he was using enormous balks of timber from skips. I hardly like to use the word punk, but there is that slight element in his early work. It's a kind of, it's a fight against respectable furniture. It's now become not so much respectable, but it's so sophisticated that it transcends all that.
Keep him off of my legs, all right?
Yeah, he keeps very, very much to his own, what he believes in. And it comes through. He won't compromise, and it's very original. And that's where the way it comes out. It's what gives it the excitement, I think, because you're seeing, in a sense, something new. And beautifully done, too.
And this was the stuff I made the legs out of. Got two more nails in it. No, it's a bit split. This one's rock. This one looks alright though. That one's alright, look. That'd be, you know, towards, maybe cut it up for legs, you know. Just slice it up into 4-inch strips and glue them together, make 4-inch blocks.
Thank you.
different type of wood. What is it?
This is an old bit of walnut, really old English walnut.
Mm.
It's about 400 years old. That's like, it's about 200-year-old slice as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's lovely, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, why do you keep it around the other way, though?
Well, just to protect this side, because I want to use it for something one day, but this is really fragile, look.
Yeah.
This comes off.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just bits of pine. This is iroka. This is an African wood, hardwood. And it's, if you hold it into the light, it gets a sort of golden colour. Can you see? Yeah. This is a bit of English oak, look, and that polishes up like that. So it's quite nice, isn't it? Look,
from that?
Yeah, from that to that. You see, you find an old bit of wood in the street and it looks like that, and I know now that that's a piece of oak, but I didn't once upon a time. I used to make a bit of furniture and I just thought it was all pine, you know? Sand it all down, it'd come up like this. It was lovely.
When did you... I mean, did you just discover by trial and error?
Yeah.
What stuff was?
And this is a bit... I mean, it's the same as... It was an old Joyce once, look. It's still got chalk on it, but I cut all the edges off and sort of coloured it down a bit, and it's going to make it into a top for a little stall or something.
Mm-hmm. And this is what, pine?
Just pitch pine, yeah. It was an old Joyce, look. These underneath floorboards.
Yeah.
And to hold ceilings up, and this is what they were. They come out of the warehouses.
It's a sort of arts and crafts. It's it's got a sort of element of William Morris in it, an element of Macintosh, an element of, you know, of element of the 19th century of Tudor furniture. That, you know, it's in that, in the true tradition of British furniture.
That was.
They always put you in really awful clothes, don't they?
Yeah, I know. Look what they put me in fashion news. Look. Look at these fucking clothes.
Oh.
This is the flat when I first moved in it. Look. Without that was my fire. I
bought this has been put in. There was nothing here.
No, there
before.
Was nothing at all.
Mm.
It's really good. Can you see that?
Mm. What's all this?
Well, that's just all the bad wall. That's like
plaster.
Yeah. No,
he has an amazing eye. I mean, Andy's flat is immaculate. He has a sort of almost Japanese sparsity. He has an extraordinary eye, Andy. Now, where that came from, I don't know. It came, you know, it's something you're born with. It must have been there. I mean, it's quite extraordinary when you walk into Andy's flat to see the sort of sophistication of the whole thing. I mean, you know, the sparsity and it's... You know, there's just a few pieces of furniture around. I think there's something to do with having, you know, run away to sea and things, about being tidy. You have to live in a small space and, you know, roll up your kit bag. That room is always remarkable because when people go down there, they may say, oh, what is this Andy really like? And I say, well, you know, you just go down there and you look at that room. And they go down there and they see that room and it's really, you can tell that someone has actually got a real, really, really acute eye. Is living there.
And in fact, he's like a lot of kids of his own generation, actually making their own thing and actually doing things and making things, and they have an enormous sense of enterprise. I should think they ought to get a prize from Mrs. Thatcher.
My life meant nothing to me. 20 years of madness, soon I tasted, took it all in one big mighty swipe. 20 years have gone and they've all been wasted. Opium pipe, oh, dream tobacco, take me away where there ain't no memories to lead me astray, where I can hear sweet.
This one's got the power to make furniture, look.
Dream tobacco.
It's a living room, look.
Is it supposed to be improvements?
Yeah.
Look at this monstrosity.
Sitting on the beach with the sky above me. Maybe there's a sea breeze right in front. I don't want the beach nor the sky above me. I don't want the sea breeze blowing on me. Many miles away is a gentle country. Waiting
for the sleepy. It didn't work.
Once I used to live in that gentle country. Now I can't believe I was born on that farm. Oh, dream tobacco, take me away, where there ain't no memories to lead me astray, where I can hear sweet music all the livelong day. Dream tobacco, take me away.
You've got to be a troublemaker if you want to get on. You've got to make people remember you, you know. You meet somebody once, you don't want them to go away and forget about you 5 minutes later. Well, I make sure they don't.
Advice, just in case you're listening, never let your fool heart rule your head. When the sun goes in...
There's no one who could tell a yarn as well as Andy can. I mean, he can keep everyone, he's like Scheherazade. He can keep everyone amused for hours. I mean, I never know whether to believe it all. But,
best girl has done you wrong. If I'd thought it out in the light of reason, I guess I wouldn't be here singing this song.
Yeah, everyone loves a bit of dirt. We all do dirty.
Has that boy been ringing you up lately?
No, it's the toilet boy.
Who's that? Oh,
I've not told you.
Tell me about the toilet boy.
What? Have I not told you?
I got this phone call a fortnight ago.
Yeah.
And he said, there's a black guy called Tony live there. And I said, yes, freaking. He said, I've just got your telephone number off a toilet. I said, that's a joke. I said, it's Bill, Andy. And I thought it was all that going through everybody. And I said, you know, he's put you up to this. He's straight, like a real lad. You know, hey, how you doing? All and so I said, we're talking about 10 minutes later, I sort of said to him, this is a fucking joke. I said, stop it, you know, and he hung up. Fucking, I'm going, oh, I've got this phone call, I'm here. I've got a bit of taste. It's the time you got my number for toilet wall. I'm telling everyone, I'm all excited and nervous. I was really nervous, but it was nice nervous. You know, it was like, I had a hard on the phone. I mean, that's how I look forward to it, you know, and I went, man, I thought, 5 minutes later, the phone rang back again, and he said, I want to meet you tonight. Peter there Daniels. Derek, that's... Oh, you've got a sharp memory.
Yeah.
Made it, mate. Your number.
It was Andy making the phone call.
Everybody else knew.
He was ringing everyone up going, I just rang up Tony and just giving him a dime.
No! Tony!
He said he'd kill me if I told him.
Always think it out in the light of reason, even though your best girl has done you wrong. If I'd thought it out in the light of reason, I guess I wouldn't be here singing this song. Oh, dream tobacco, take me away, where there ain't no memories to lead me astray, where I can hear sweet music all the livelong day. Dream tobacco, take me away.